stay with Radio 2. Through the day, through the night, and round the clock.
From Land's End to John O'Groat, this is the Peter Dickson Show on National Radio 2.
Loves, this is Dorian here, Peter's producer. Well, I don't know what to say, because Peter hasn't turned up yet, and I can't think for the life of me what's happened to him, because he's usually so punctual, see. Well, oh, that'll be him now. Hang on a sec. Hello, Radio 2? Hello? Oh.
Hello, Dorian.
Yeah, where are you, Peter?
Look, Dorian, look, I'm stuck in a traffic jam in Regent Street. Look, I've just popped out of the car to call you from this phone box.
But, Peter, love, it's after one.
Yes, look, I know. Look, just start without me. I'll be along as soon as I can.
This is hard. It's hardly professional,
look,
dear.
Get on with it, Dorian.
Oh, we are in a mood, aren't we? Oh, well, play the record then, dear.
How deep is the ocean? How high is the sky?
Yes, I'm here now. Thank you, Dorian. Yes. Cross questions and crooked answers. That's Tom Jones. How deep is the ocean? How long is Regent Street, for goodness sake? Yes.
Too long, obviously, dear.
Yes, thank you, yes. Thanks to Peter Clayton, by the way, and the toe-tapping troglodytes in the basement. And welcome to Night Ride. Sure, you might as well stay, provided you clean up after you, you know.
Firefly, cause oh my, he radiates moon glow. What's none of that new glow? He starts to glitter when the sun goes down by 8 p.m. It's mayhem. He switches those brights up, lights up, and gives me a call. Hey, take me to the Firefly Ball. But when I get him there, set him there, too, I want to pet him there and grab me some glow. Though he's a gadabout, mad about blowing every gal about while leaping me moaning low. Oh, Firefly, why can't I latch onto you know-how? Oh, how I love you, but gee, why you set the night on fire, fly? Shine a little light on me. When the sun goes down about 8 p.m., it's mayhem. He switches those brights up, lights up, and gives me a call. Hey, take me to the Firefly Ball. But when I get him there, set him there, too, I want to pet him there and grab me some glow. So he's a gadabout, mad about blowing every gal about while leaving me moaning low. Oh, Firefly, why can't I? Let's under you know how. Oh, how I love you, but gee, why did you set the night on fire? Shine a little light on, shine a little light on, shine a little light on me.
That's Jeannie Lamb and Brian Lemon and his Dixielanders and Firefly.
This is Radio 2, FM stereo. 693-4909.
My, have I got a box of scratchy old records for you tonight. Great stuff. Sade will be here, Johnny Mathis, Singers Unlimited, John Fogerty. Who? The New Jersey Mass Choir, Ronnie Aldridge, Julie London, everyone's here. And we'll be playing musical roulette in about another 10 minutes. Go on, force yourself. The Radio Orchestra, conducted by Mike Townend. 14 minutes past one, that's Roller Jubilee. Let's take a look now what we have in the rest of Night Ride for you, in this first hour at least. In about 15 minutes at 1:30, Barney Lawrence, all the way from Arabia. He'll be here with his back boiler, his balanced flue and cylinder stat, and the rest of his central heating system. We also hear about the unique sighting of the world's first flying pig, and why a ladies' aerobics class in Gloucester was banned on safety grounds. Yes, all that between now and two. I don't know how we do it for the money, you know.
You're lucky people.
These are the Mike Sam singers for you now, Perhaps Love.
Perhaps love is like a resting place, a shelter from the storm. It exists to give you comfort, it is there to keep you warm. And in those times of trouble, when you are most alone, the memory of love will bring you home.
come closer. It wants to show you more. And even if you lose yourself and don't know what to do, the memory of love will see you through.
Smoothies, you like that, didn't you? That's the Mike Sam Singers and John Denver's Perhaps Love. David Smelly, that is a name to conjure with. He writes to me from King's Lynn in Norfolk. Dear Peter, I've been listening to you presenting Night Ride for some time now, and I've come to the conclusion that anyone could do it. Mm-hmm. Perhaps if you don't feel like coming in some night, I could sit in and present the show for you. When can you start then, eh, David? When can you start? P.S. What do you call an Irishman with two panes of glass in his head? Patio doors.
With another girl in vain. With another heart.
I bet you say that to all the boys. I met your sort before. Go, get out of it! Thank you, dear. Yes, yes indeed, we'll let you know, thank you. At Sharday, Sadie to her friends and Smooth Operator. 22 minutes past one now is the time. If you'd like to drop me a line on Night Ride, please don't feel ashamed or embarrassed about it. We're all consenting adults, and it's in private, so you can drop me a line. Peter Dickson's the name. Night Ride's the programme. BBC London W1A4WW. Let me know what you're up to. I'm a bit intrigued to know. This is Johnny Mathis for you now. What I Did for Love.
The sweetness and the sorrow. We did what we had. And I can't regret what I did for love, what I did for love.
Good old Johnny. That's Johnny Mathis, what he did for love. Well, we don't want to hear about it now, thank you. Keep it for afterwards. Who was in here last? This studio is a picture of filth. I wouldn't keep a dog in here. Look at the state of this place. Let's get this. Look, can we just, before we go any further, please, can we get this place sorted out for once and for all? Give me that item. I'm left around here to do everything, right? Cleaner, DJ, all alone. No, not a friend in the world. I don't know. Just talk amongst yourselves there.
Come running to see you again.
I've got no friends. None.
Winter, spring, summer, and fall.
Nobody loves me.
All you have to do is call.
I'm destitute.
And I'll be there.
Your place or mine?
You've got a friend.
Gee, but I'm touched. I'm really moved. Singers Unlimited there, thank you. You've got a friend. Here's a flying pig. The first flying pig of the year has been sighted in Exeter. And according to today's Daily Mirror, I think it is, a pig apparently fell and flew from a lorry on the M5 near Exeter yesterday and landed on the car bonnet of a 34-year-old secretary named, wait for it, Linda Hogg. The pig was killed.
Peter Dickson. On Nighttime Radio 2.
John Fogerty now. And after this, we'll hear from old Barney Lawrence and his central heating system. 1:30. Let's get this show moving. John Fogerty, Centrefield. What the deuce was all that about? What? Answer. Thank you. Give these people an inch and they take a mile. It's 25 minutes to two now, and time for Life with Lawrence. Barney Lawrence is here, and he's brought his central heating system with him. Barney.
My central heating is musical. It hums. Not just one note, but several. And if I told you it was all because of a little grey knob, I don't think you'd believe me. So I think I'd better explain. Now, I'm a great believer in the saying that anything he can do, I can do too. And you'll notice I'm not trying to do it better than him, just trying to do it no matter what the outcome. And I expect you've noticed, like me, that if something is going to go wrong, then it'll always choose to do so at the worst possible moment. So when do you think my central heating broke down? That's right. Dead in the middle of the cold spell. When a strange screaming noise of metal on metal emanated from the vicinity of my boiler, the first reaction was to call a plumber. Well, when does the local trades directory decide to go missing? Well, after I'd found another way of propping up the wardrobe, I phoned several plumbers, only to find that the soonest any of them could come was 3 days. Well, to be fair, they were all terribly apologetic and awfully nice about it, but that didn't alter my problem. I held the telephone near the working boiler, and the plumber on the other end gave me a definitive diagnosis of the banshee wailing. It's your pump, mate. I can come Sunday, double time, though. Politely, yet firmly, I declined his offer and gave the pump a long, hard, hate-filled look, hoping to stir its conscience into action. But it sat there, silently laughing, a round, blue, metallic object held in the pipe by 2 of the most enormous nuts I have ever seen. It was at that precise moment, as I gazed at those large, brass-faceted rings, that I decided to do the job myself. After all, it was just a matter of taking out the old pump and putting in a new one. So, back to the directory I went and proudly returned home 20 minutes later, clutching my shiny, brand-new boxed pump. Ringing in my ears was all sorts of advice, which had served but one purpose, to confuse and frighten me. Well, whoever had installed my system had foreseen the likelihood of the pump being replaced and had put a tap on either side of it. Tentatively, I turned both taps as far as they would go. Out of my toolkit, I produced a long-forgotten wrench which just fitted round the enormous nuts. But try as I might, I couldn't shift either one of them. The pump swiveled backwards and forwards in perfect time to my wrenching, but it was the nut that was supposed to move while the pump stayed still. Some time later, with the pump wedged in place using a Heath Robinson mixture of wooden blocks, wedges and a disused mallet handle, I strained at the nuts once again. And as you've no doubt guessed, they didn't move. Not even 1 millimetre. The wedges fell down several times, though, and I was beginning to doubt the truth of my saying. And a piece of that advice flickered into my mind. It had made no sense at the time, but suddenly all became crystal clear. If they're stiff, mate, eat 'em up with a blow lamp. But not too much. Well, soon I was tentatively doing just that. The wedges were replaced, and with one twist, the nut moved. Suddenly, the doubt was gone. Anything he could do, I could do too. So I repositioned the wrench and gave another twist. Water, very hot water at that, spurtled out under pressure from around the loosened nut. I dropped the wrench and jumped back. The wedges fell down and the water continued to pour. I grabbed a cloth and, approaching the hissing, steaming water in the manner of a bullfighter, wrapped the cloth round the leaking joint, placed a bucket under the flow and waited for it to stop. Which it didn't. My shoes were awash. My dirty hands smarting from the hot water. Dripping rags dangling from the pipes and a bucket rapidly filling with hot water doing a very good impression of a portable Turkish bath. I came within a hair's breadth of capitulation. The trouble was, I couldn't. No plumber could get to me for 3 days. I paused. A very useful thing is a pause, a time for reflection. And it wasn't long before I deduced that the taps had not turned off the water supply completely. Lo and behold, by wiggling both taps back and forth, each one turned about 3 more revolutions. Miraculously, the water stopped just before the bucket was due to overflow. My luck had changed, I was sure of it. Well, the old pump slid out easily, and to make the joints completely waterproof, I smeared each surface, washer and thread, with some slimy, gritty, pale beige gunge that plumbers euphemistically call boss white. Put the new pump into the gap in the pipes, screwed up the coated nuts. And it was as simple as that. There was a gleaming new pump in place of the rusty old one, and believe me, I was feeling suitably chuffed. I had done it. All that remained now was to switch on. My mood instantly changed, unwilling to submit to the final telling test. But the boiler lit, and the pump hummed into action. It actually worked. Well, while indulging in a self-satisfied pause, I slowly became conscious of a very persistent hum in every single radiator upstairs and down, pitched neatly at middle C. Well, after a brief examination of the pump, I found a dial which was at that moment set to maximum, and as I swiveled the knob, so the pitch decreased till at a certain point the hum completely disappeared. So you won't be surprised, will you, to find me kneeling as if in supplication while I composed tunes on my central heating, just by finding the right position of that little grey knob.
Thank you, Barney. That's Barney Lawrence and his amazing musical central heating system. Now here's a little bonus for you, because Barry Forgy was so inspired by Barney's experience with his central heating that he himself was moved to arrange a version of Royal Garden Blues, and he plays it now for us on his own central heating system. Still Barry, I think the original is much better, actually, myself, come to think of it. That's better.
Thank you.
they make a fine sound, don't they? The BBC Big Band, conducted by Big Bad Barry, and Royal Garden Blues with Gordon Keats on solo clarinet. It's exactly 1:45 already, and I've just been sorting through the mail here. The letters have come flooding in here in their tens. And here's an interesting one from Mrs. Jennifer Cogan from Spitsbury in Dorset. She writes to me with a very interesting challenge. And one which I may very well take up, Jennifer. I'll tell you about it after this. This is Ronnie Aldridge and his orchestra now. Roger Whittaker's The Last Farewell.